Today on Christian World News, a Florida judge orders Rivka Berry returned to Ohio, but the 17-year-old Christian's future is still unclear. And they're on trial for defending their Christian faith, the case that's testing freedom of speech in the UK. Plus, the political crisis in Honduras drags on. How churches are helping solve the problem. Welcome to Christian World News. I'm Mark Martin. Rivka Berry has been ordered back to Ohio by a Florida judge. Berry is the teenager who ran away from her Muslim family after she converted to Christianity. We have two reports, beginning in Florida, where a twist in the case could keep Rivka there a little longer. Here's Wendy Griffith.
A dramatic day in the case of teenage runaway Rivka Berry. Orlando Judge Daniel Dawson agreed with an Ohio judge that Berry should be sent back to Ohio almost immediately. But then it was discovered that her immigration papers still had not been sent by her parents. That brought into question whether she was actually in the U.S. legally. Her attorney argued that if she is here illegally, that could put her in imminent danger of being sent back to her home country of Sri Lanka.
The reason that Rivka left is because her parents threatened to send her back to Sri Lanka. And this is the issue nobody wants to talk about, but apostate killing is a very real thing. And she is most
objection, Judge.
Risk.
At this point, we are going into the anti-Muslim bias that's been basically dragging this through the last 3 months already.
I'll note your Judge. Objection. Hold it. I'll note your objection. Let him finish.
Judge, it's a very real thing. She's sent back to Sri Lanka. It's probably the place she's most at risk of being killed or harmed or put in the insane asylum. And so this immigration issue is very, very critical.
Judge Dawson agreed, saying he had grave concerns as to why those documents, including passports, visas, and other information, had not been supplied to the court when they'd been ordered months ago. And when the attorney for the parents offered excuses, the judge wasn't buying.
Listen to an oration about apostasy.
Stop. Unless you want to be held in contempt and go out the other door, you need to just stop and listen to the court. All I want to know is how soon can you get the immigration paperwork to the court and to the jail, period.
The judge ordered the immigration documents be sent within 10 working days or the parents will be held in contempt of court. He also ordered that the virtual schooling Rivka's been receiving in Florida continue in Ohio.
Friends and supporters of Rivka say they're thrilled that she'll be staying in Florida a little longer than expected. Many believe she's safer here than in Ohio. And some who've talked to her say whatever her fate, she's ready.
Right before Rivka fled Ohio, she said, "Pray for me that I would not deny Jesus Christ in the face of death." That was her heart. Not many of us have had to face that. She's one of the few in this country that have had to look death in the face, and she's prepared for it.
So for now, Judge Dawson says Rivka Berry is not going anywhere until those important immigration papers are presented to the court. And that makes many of her supporters very happy. Wendy Griffith, CBN News, Orlando.
This is Ephraim Graham in Columbus, Ohio, where attorneys are under a gag order, but Rivka Berry's friends are talking. And they aren't happy.
Not really good. It would be best if she stayed in Florida.
Robert Ng lives about a mile from Rivka Berry's suburban Columbus home. The young Christians met less than a year ago, attended prayer meetings together, and talked nearly every day until she ran away more than 2 months ago.
I've Skyped her while she's in Florida. She's still on Facebook under her name, and I messaged her on there, so.
Ng also prayed with Rivka and talked about the possibility of her return to Columbus even before Tuesday's court ruling.
With talking to her before today, she kind of knew that she would have to. She prayed that she didn't, but that she got the feeling that she would be coming back.
Do you think she's worried about coming back?
I wouldn't use the word worry, but I think she knows that coming back here is more dangerous than her staying in Florida.
That is a fear members of this Columbus mosque, the Noor Islamic Center, have called unwarranted.
On YouTube, when you see the stuff, the excerpts with her about the interview and how she claims things, she's very passionate, and you can definitely sense that she's scared. But the reasons for this, those are the things that we're completely just dumbfounded on. We have no idea where those things are coming from.
For now, The courts are siding with members of the Islamic community and Rivka's parents, with an order for her to return to Ohio, where she'll be temporarily in foster care.
Though a Florida judge ordered Rivka Berry returned here to Columbus, Ohio, that move will not happen overnight. There are still a number of issues that must be settled. A hearing is now set here at Franklin County Juvenile Court, October 27th. In Columbus, Ohio, Ephraim Graham, CBN News.
Turning now to Iran, where two Christian women are charged with the crimes of apostasy and propagating Christianity. Maryam and Marjeh could be convicted or could be given life in prison if convicted. They've been imprisoned for more than 6 months and reportedly are in poor health. In a court appearance last August, the pair refused to recant their Christian faith. International Christian Concern reports the women have endured solitary confinement and been deprived of medical treatment. In England, a Christian couple is facing trial and could lose their business simply for having a debate about religion with a Muslim. UK correspondent Peter Wooding reports from Liverpool.
When the Christian owners of a hotel in the northwest of England entered into a debate about Islam with a Muslim guest, little did they realize they would be prosecuted for a crime. Police arrested Ben and Sharon Vogelenzang, who run the Bounty House Hotel in Liverpool, after a Muslim woman complained that she was offended by comments made back in March of this year. Because the legal case is ongoing, the couple cannot comment publicly. According to newspaper reports, the debate here at the hotel involved discussion of whether Jesus was the Son of God or just a minor prophet of Islam. Newspapers also reported that the debate included comments that Muhammad was a warlord and that Muslim dress for women was a form of bondage. However, the facts of the case are disputed, according to Mike Judge from the Christian Institute, a legal organization that's helping fund the couple's defense. And he says it's important that Christians defend their right to talk about their faith.
Freedom of speech is something that is protected in England, but it is being eroded. And there are cases of Christians now being told by police officers that they are not allowed to express their religious beliefs in a public setting.
Mike says the allegations have caused the couple serious financial harm. The hotel has seen an 80% drop in its income because a local hospital used to book its local outpatients there.
As a result of this case and the criminal charges that have been put against these Christians, the hospital has decided not to send its outpatients there anymore. So you can imagine that's had a huge impact on Ben and Sharon's business.
Despite this, Ben and Sharon have been overwhelmed by the support they've received from Christians around the world.
Ben and Sharon are greatly disturbed at the thought of being facing criminal charges for defending their faith. They're disturbed at the fear of losing their business, but they've been tremendously encouraged by hundreds and hundreds of Christians from all over the world emailing in to say, we're standing with you, we're praying with you, we're horrified that this is happening to you, and we hope that you succeed in your legal defense.
The pair are now being prosecuted for a public order offense when someone feels insulted for their membership of a religious group. But Mike says this case raises significant free speech and religious liberty issues.
The reason this case is so important is that the freedom to share the gospel in a Christian country really needs to be paramount. And if people can't get involved in a debate about religion, then we are losing our freedom of speech. And this is not just an issue that we're facing in Britain, but we're facing it in other Western countries as well. And Christians across those nations have to stand together to defend our freedom of speech.
A criminal trial is set for December the 8th and the 9th here at Liverpool Magistrates Court. If convicted, the couple face a maximum fine of £5,000. That's the equivalent of $8,000, and they'll have a criminal record. This case raises major concerns for Christians across the UK who are worried they're losing their right to talk freely about their beliefs. Peter Wooding for CBN News, Liverpool, England.
Up next, they call it La Familia, a crime family that uses religion to recruit members and keep them in line.
CWNews.org, your constant news source on the World Wide Web. Find daily updates on the global church. Watch the weekly broadcast.
Three former presidents come together to honor the life and ministry.
Also available in podcasts. The in-depth insights into our reporter blogs.
Taliban kidnapped at least 18 in South Peru, Korean Christians.
Your online news source for complete coverage of the global church.
Thanks, Pete. Hi, I'm Terry Musin. We receive so many letters and emails from viewers who say their day just isn't the same if they don't see the 700 Club. That's why I'm so excited to tell you that you'll never have to miss another show. The 700 Club's here for you every Monday through Friday with stories of hope and encouragement, practical information to make your life better, and insight you need to make sense of what's going on in the world. It's never been easier to see the 700 Club, even if breaking news interrupts us, you can still watch the show. Call this number or go to CBN.com to get this list of all the different channels in your area where you can see the 700 Club. With the 700 Club airing on so many channels, you can choose the one that's best for you. So remember, no matter what happens, whether it's big or small, you can always see the 700 Club.
Call or log on to CBN.com for this important information.
Yeah, buddy.
How many nickels are in a dollar?
There are 20 nickels in a dollar.
How do birds fly? Does milk really make my bones stronger?
Yeah.
Daddy, when we die, will we go to heaven?
Do you have the answer to life's biggest question? Call the 700 Club. We'll help you find answers to the important questions life brings your way.
It has been 3 months since Honduran President Manuel Zelaya was removed from power. Now the country seems to be closing in on a solution to its political crisis, a solution that includes the country's churches. Stan Jeter reports from Tegucigalpa.
Manuel Zelaya clings to sanctuary in the Brazilian embassy. The dispute over who should be president has moved from the streets to the negotiating table.
I believe that we're on the right track now, that all the actors are within the framework of the Honduran territory, and that allows to view the Honduran problem as a domestic problem, as subject to Honduran jurisdiction and to Honduran law.
One of the more popular options on the table is that President Roberto Micheletti turned the presidency over to another interim leader and deposed President Zelaya, give up his presidential claims. And in January, the winner of the upcoming presidential elections would take power. On a morning talk show, Denis Gomes, a member of the Electoral Tribunal, assures that the elections will be carefully monitored. Pastor Pedro Reyes is a regular on this talk show.
The vote for us as a church, as faith, is sacred. And when we give our vote to someone, we're transferring authority to him.
Before the crisis began, the leaders of the Vida Abundante Church here in Tegucigalpa saw the need to involve more Hondurans in the democratic process, to fight voter apathy and ignorance. Voter education tools produced by the church include this music video.
For decades, we have been taught that politics is dirty, it's bad, it's of the devil, and we shouldn't get involved with the affairs of this world. And then, unfortunately, we allow a few people to manage public affairs while the church suffers the consequences.
Pastor Evelio Reyes leads the Vida Abundante Church. His civic involvement has even won the admiration of resistance leaders. Marwin Ponce is an opposition delegate in the National Congress.
In my case, I'm from the Catholic Church, but the Vida Abundante Church gave me recognition because of my honesty, my struggle for my decency, my work, my relationship with the poor. They presented me as an example, and that helped me a lot in the electoral process.
Many Honduran pastors are convinced that whatever the politicians may eventually decide, the churches of Honduras will be part of the solution, not part of the problem. Stan Jeter, Tegucigalpa, Honduras.
In Caracas, Venezuela, Christians put aside political issues to march for Jesus this week. Thousands of believers from different churches marched from both the east and west ends of the city, stopping along the way to pray for the peace of the nation and Venezuelan families. The annual event has become a uniting factor for the country's churches, which are often divided by political differences. In Mexico, federal police are engaged in an all-out war against powerful drug cartels. Gary Lane tells us about a cartel in southwestern Mexico that uses faith to justify its criminal activities.
One might not expect a federal drug raid at a Catholic church, but in Mexico it's happening regularly, all because of the violent cartel known as La Familia, or The Family. According to local authorities, this violent organization destroys everything in its path as it works to send tons of synthetic drugs to the United States. What makes the La Familia cartel different from others is its cult-like use of religious faith to recruit and control their members, and worse, to justify their crimes.
This is not new in militant organizations like the Taliban.
Security expert Pablo Monsalvo has directed several police forces in Mexico. He says drug cartels want loyalty from their members.
When they claim a religious and ideological doctrine, they are going straight to the inner fibers of the Mexican heart.
Many Mexicans are deeply committed to faith and family, a belief system easily exploited by the cartel's leadership. While police brand them as murderers, leaders of La Familia say they have a divine right to dole out justice and discipline for cartel members. Police investigators discovered this document where the leader explains his beliefs with phrases like this: "Is your heart where the grace of God lies? Such is my pain that I don't want to exist anymore. I pray to God for strength." Local pastors are keeping their distance. They believe there's a huge difference between the God cartel members claim to follow and the God of the Bible.
In this part of our country, 99% of the people consider themselves Christians. But I wonder, what God do you believe in? Demons believe in God too, and they tremble. But where are the results?
And the church is also paying a price. Pastor Fernando Delgado says, these are hard days for the gospel.
Some pastors have received threats, and the son of a pastor was kidnapped accidentally. Thank God they set him free. The preaching of the gospel has been affected, but we keep doing our part.
Next year, Mexico will celebrate 200 years of independence from Spain. Today, two centuries later, it wages another war of survival, not against an external threat, but against an enemy from within. Gary Lane, CBN News.
Coming up on Christian World News, Africa's most vulnerable population and the ministry that's trying to save them.
It's the one thing news viewers can agree on.
They want change.
Now, the world's leading Christian news organization brings you national, international news and analysis throughout the day. Mornings, the busy lunch hour, late afternoon, and evenings. It's news with a Christian perspective whenever you want it. Available on the web 24/7 at cbnnews.com. Do the miracles of Jesus still happen today?
Pastor had walked over and prayed for this illness, and all of a sudden, everything stopped.
Can the blind be made to see?
I could see two walls at one time. I could see things. I could see stuff over here and here.
Are the dead brought back to life?
When I prayed that prayer, Fatima, raised in the name of Jesus,
immediately I found myself in my body.
Jesus still does miracles today. Experience his incredible power in Pat Robertson's newest teaching, Miracles Beyond Measure.
If you have faith in God, then nothing, nothing will be impossible for you.
Join the 700 Club and receive this life-changing new teaching, Miracles Beyond Measure, available now.
co-host of the 700 Club, I see incredible stories of God's faithfulness to our viewers every day. It builds our faith to see what God is doing in people's lives. Perhaps you've seen a miracle in your finances. We'd like to share your story with others so that they too can be encouraged. Please call 1-800-759-0700 or log on to CBN.com. We want to hear from you. Your life can inspire others.
In Eastern Africa, there are reports of widespread atrocities, including murder and rape. It's happening in the eastern part of the Democratic Republic of Congo. Human rights groups report that at least 1,000 civilians have been killed and nearly 900,000 displaced. A report from a coalition of rights groups charges Hutu militia from neighboring Rwanda with many of the crimes. Some Congolese government soldiers are also accused. Women are the target of many of the attacks. The report says 7,000 women and girls have been raped. John Castle of CBN Africa recently traveled to Eastern Congo, and he met up with a ministry called the Dina Foundation, which is rescuing girls from that danger. He went along on one of those missions and told us all about it.
I was with the team that went about 2 hours out into the remote bush to one of the larger villages in one of the worst areas where the worst fighting and trouble has been. And this is where we interviewed maybe 20 girls. And these girls are just relating mind-bending stories of brutality, how their mother or brothers and sisters had asked them to go out and gather some beans or something to eat. And they went out into the woods, and here these men were laying in wait, just waiting for any girl or woman to come along to take advantage of them. And then the girls would be surprised and raped and terrible, terrible things like this. There might be several men involved. This might have happened on more than one occasion to these girls. It's just absolutely unbelievable. We took these girls in a minivan along with us back to the Dina Foundation and went back the next day. They had washed their clothes. They'd hung them out to dry. They had given them other clothes, new clothes to wear. These girls had a good meal the previous night. They had a breakfast in the morning, and these girls were out playing in the yard there. And these girls were smiling and enjoying friendship and fellowship with other girls that had been in similar situations, now in a safe haven with food, clothing, and fellowship, and soon they'll be getting a Christian education and learning about Jesus.
Now, CBN's Orphans Promise is partnering with the Dina Foundation to give these girls a better life. If you want to take part, you can find out how at our website, cwnews.org. In the Asian nation of Thailand, a growing number of women are contracting AIDS. One Christian ministry is helping victims who live with the deadly disease, telling them that they can experience new life. Lucille Talusan reports from Bangkok.
Patty was pregnant with her first child when she found out she was infected with HIV/AIDS. She contracted the virus from her husband, a drug addict who was infected through a needle.
I wanted to kill my husband and then kill myself. In those days, HIV was not accepted. People stared at me as if I was a loose woman who slept with everybody. And I was concerned for my child. The doctor said she may get infected.
Pakti said her husband convinced her to just accept their fate.
He said, "Why should we kill ourselves? You're strong. I will stay with you and be responsible for the baby. Everybody has to die someday anyway, so just let it be."
At her lowest moment, a friend brought Pakti to Siam Care Foundation to seek help. Siam Care is a Christian organization that ministers to HIV-affected people and their families. Director Adrian Lomborg shares how the ministry helps the women face their battle against HIV/AIDS.
One is the care, where we work with the affected families already, where you look at the whole person, right? You don't just care for people in their physical way or their emotional way, but it's integrated into who we are spiritually. The other is prevention. We run groups in villages, in slum communities, in schools where we teach about HIV.
It also teaches women that they deserve respect and kindness from their husbands.
Thai women in general are very accepting, forgiving, as they would say, but I actually think it's a cover-up for fatalism. In the culture is quite fatalistic in many, many points. So what I want for the women is to really realize that they are special, that they are created in God's image, and that there is a plan for their lives. And that is a good plan. That's not a plan of sickness and being downtrodden.
Pakti is among the 700,000 officially recorded people in Thailand living with HIV/AIDS. The national HIV prevalence is 1.4%.
Now, in terms of number, it's just like saying that out of 60 Thai people passing through this marketplace, at least one is positive with HIV/AIDS. Over the past year, the rate of infection among teenagers increased from 11 to 17%. Now that is even more alarming.
The youth is becoming, over the genders, male and female, much more promiscuous. Thai teenagers are sexually active at quite a young age. The average age is said to be around 14.
Pakti is still living with her husband and now has 4 children. Amazingly, none of her children is positive with HIV/AIDS. Her eldest daughter, she was pregnant with when she was infected with the disease, is now a teenager. Pakti believes that only God can miraculously spare her 4 children from contracting HIV/AIDS. And this is why she brings them to the Siam Care Center regularly, for them to know more about God. It's been 13 years since Pakti has been diagnosed with HIV/AIDS. Her future may be uncertain, but with her newfound faith, she has decided to live life to the fullest. The people in Siam Care helped me to walk the right path. I called out to God, and God gave me new life to be with my children, and the strength to fight and live this new life. Lucille Talusan, CBN News, Bangkok, Thailand.
I have the privilege of traveling all over the world and seeing firsthand the life-changing things you make possible through your partnership. Thank you for joining the 700 Club. Here in India, you're demonstrating the love of God to such wonderful people, most of whom are in great need, both physically and spiritually. You're bringing hope and joy to millions around the world. Just like you did for Chen Yu, born with a serious heart defect, doctors said he would soon die. His parents couldn't afford surgery. That's when you provided the operation that saved his life. Your monthly gift makes it possible to heal the sick, feed the hungry, and preach the gospel, both at home in America and throughout the world. So please watch for this mailing and send in your pledge. Imagine lifting someone's life out of despair and filling it with hope instead. That's what you make possible every day. And it only happens because you were there.
Finally this week, the prestigious Medal of Honor could be awarded to a Kansas priest who served during the Korean War. Father Emil Capon was an army chaplain when he was taken prisoner by the Chinese in 1950. In prison, Capon ignored his own health to provide food and water to fellow prisoners. He died at that camp 7 months after he was taken captive. Capon will be the 8th chaplain to receive the coveted award if Congress approves his nomination, and we hope they do. Well, that's our report for this week. We'll see you here next week. Goodbye, and may God bless you.